is on COVID-19 vaccine, the way forward. This is by Dr. Shailesh Bonded. I request Dr. Shukla to come forward and introduce the speaker. I can see Dr. Arvind Mathur. Thank you very much, sir, for joining.
It's my privilege to be here today for a very important session, really.
Thank you, sir.
This session is the one everybody is looking at right now in present COVID time.
Please. Right. Can we have the introduction of Dr. Shailesh Bonded, please?
Dr. Shailesh Bonded, he is a global medical director of BioMarin Pharmaceuticals in California. And he has been in, I think, US from almost a decade. And he has expertise in the area of clinical trial and drug development. And he has contributed to study designs, drafting, and finalization of study protocol. When the pandemic broke out, and he was the one who was, I think we were all asking about what is the latest developments in vaccine. And he knows, he has a lot of inside information about what is happening in US for the vaccine in the COVID. So I think without wasting time, I'll give over to Dr. Shailesh. Over to Dr. Shailesh.
Good afternoon, everyone. Myself, Dr. Shailesh Bonded. Thanks, Ravindra Shukla, for giving a brief description about me. Can you guys see my screen?
Yes. Your screen is visible. Yes.
Yes. Okay, so.
It's not full screen. If you could just.
I will bring this on the slideshow. Before that, thank you very much and good afternoon. So I'm a medical director working in South San Francisco area. Basically South San Francisco, California is known for a biotechnology industry, and it is the hub of drug development and clinical research. And this is the reason I choose this area and working since long time in this area. And I have good experience in working in multiple therapeutics area. But now, as you know, this is the pandemic, COVID-19 pandemic. So I gathered a lot of information regarding the COVID-19 vaccines, and I would like to share my knowledge about it. So before I describe about COVID-19 vaccine, it is very important to understand that how the vaccines are developed. And then I will give you the brief information, like what is the current status of the COVID-19 vaccine. So as you can see on my screen here, so this is the life cycle of the COVID of the vaccines. So basically, for every vaccines or any medicinal product, there are the stages of development and the life cycle in the life cycle. So basically, initially there is a exploratory phase, and that we call it as a basic research or the discovery phase. And once the discovery is done, so after that it goes into the preclinical studies. Basically, preclinical studies, we do the testing in the animals, and in the animal studies, the main objective of the animal studies are toxicity of the medicinal product or the vaccine. So that we call it as a safety. So once the safety is identified and we feel that this vaccine is or the this medicinal product is suitable for human, then after that we submit the IND, that is the investigational new drug application, to the regulatory agency, and they review the preclinical study data, and after that they allow us to introduce this medicinal product into the humans. So once it is introduced into the human, it comes into the clinical trial phase. So in the clinical trial, there are multiple phases: phase one, phase two, and phase three studies. So basically, as this is the vaccine, so most of the patients are the healthy volunteer here, because we want to know the efficacy in the healthy volunteer and are they producing the antibodies against these vaccines or not. So the basic objective in the clinical trials are mostly efficacy, safety, and the immunogenicity. So these are the three objectives we need to identify in that. So once the phase three study is completed, after that we submit the application to the regulatory agency. Here you can see the FDA in the United States, and there are the different regulatory agency throughout the world. So that new drug application is for the general medicines, but for the vaccines, we call it as a BLA, biological license applications. And once it is reviewed by FDA or the regulatory agency, so if they agree with the safety and the efficacy of the vaccine, they approve the vaccine. But even after the approval, there is another review that is called advisory committee review. In the advisory committee review, mostly they always ask us to do for some recommendations, like the commitment or the post-marketing commitment. So that's how we get some commitment into the phase four. That is nothing but the after the approval, that is the post-marketing commitments, mostly the post-marketing studies. So this is the basic life cycle of every vaccines. And as you know, like on average, all the vaccines development usually take 10 to 15 years. So, and now everyone's are like very much enthusiastic to know that when the COVID-19 vaccines are coming. So there are a lot of rumors going on in social media, even in the news channels, that some vaccines are already available and some are coming very soon. So I'm just trying to give you some facts about it. So basically, yes, even though it takes 10 to 15 years for the regular vaccine development, but this time, based on our good experience and the technology, we are trying to get this done within 1 or 2 years, but not like within a month. So how is it possible? How we can do this in a couple of years, which usually take the 10 to 15 years? So basically, there are some factors. As I mentioned earlier, that we have some exploratory phase. So most of these discoveries are already done at the time of SARS and Middle East Respiratory Syndrome. So we collected that data and already started our preclinical studies in animal. So we have saved most of the time in that. And also we had some clinical trial experience from these previous studies. So we collected that data and started the new trials, which obviously reduce the timelines here. The another factor is expediting data analysis. As this is a pandemic, all the companies, all the institutions, they wanted to done as a high priority, and even with the regulatory agencies as well. So basically, most of the studies we are submitting this data as an interim analysis. So what is the interim analysis? Even though study is ongoing, so we are continuously submitting the safety and the efficacy and the immunogenicity data to the regulatory agency, and they are simultaneously reviewing that data. So ultimately it is saving the time. Like as I mentioned here, after the phase three study, we submit the clinical study report to the FDA and the application to the NDA, NDA application to the FDA, and they review that. But basically at this point, they are simultaneously reviewing. So this is how we are saving a lot of time here. So So what is the current status now? So as we are, we know, like most of the pharmaceutical companies, they are like working very hard. So that include like Johnson & Johnson, AstraZeneca, GSK, which already have a very good experience in vaccines development. So they have an alliance with other biotechnology companies, with governments, universities, institutions to accelerate this progress of effective vaccine. So as of now, like till September, currently there are 321 vaccines are in the different phases of the preclinical and the clinical development globally. So that's a huge amount. Like basically most in every country, like there are some trials are ongoing. Most of them are in US and Europe, and even in, most of them are in China as well. So out of these 321, 42 vaccines are in clinical trial phase. So remaining are still in the preclinical studies, but definitely they will come soon into the clinical trial phase, or most of them maybe get rejected as they are not, as their safety is not sufficient to introduce into the human. So currently there are 42 vaccines in clinical phase, out of these 33 are in phase 1 and phase 2. So, and currently only 9 vaccines are in phase 2 and phase 3, basically in phase 3 trials. So whatever are these 9 vaccines are in phase 3 trial, like which are very promising, I will give you a little bit descriptions about these vaccines which are in the phase 3 studies and their approval timeline. So, but before that, like there is some list of companies and the institution which are in the supporting slides. I can show you later. There are the around more than 300 companies which are working together in the alliance to get this vaccine trial completed. So now I'm trying to give you some information on the COVID vaccine categories. So basically, there are multiple vaccines trials ongoing, right? So there are different type of vaccines, like protein subunit, non-replicating viral vectors. So most common trials are going on the coronavirus spike proteins, which is the primary antigen for the COVID-19 infection. So you see there are the 76 trials ongoing on the protein subunit. That is mostly coronavirus spike protein, and then non-replicating viral vector, RNA-based vaccines, replicating viral vector, DNA-based vaccines, inactivated vaccines, virus-like proteins, and live attenuated vaccines, virus. So because of the like limited time duration, I'm not able to describe each and everything, which is very interesting basically how these vaccines are developed here, but basically I'm focusing today on the current status. So these are the types of vaccines we are trying to develop. So as I mentioned earlier, I'm just giving you a high level information on the phase 3 studies which are ongoing currently. So many of you might have heard about the news about the AstraZeneca vaccines, what's going on with that. There are many rumors about it that this trial is suspended, and now we will not be able to get the vaccine. And that was the even official news here in US as well regarding the AstraZeneca vaccine. So there are some rumors about it, but basically it's a process. It's a part of the process of the vaccine development that if any adverse event occur, so there is a pharmacovigilance department. They have the power that they can stop the clinical trial. However, during their review, it is observed that on 8th of September 2020, one of the subjects experienced a neurological adverse event but later on further review, it is determined that the causality of that adverse event is not related to the vaccine. And they, after like 4 days, they resume the clinical trial, because safety is very important for all the products. So if it is not safe for human, pharmacovigilance department have a right to stop that trial. So that's what happened at this stage. And there was a lot of rumor came. However, studies already resumed, and they have the target completion date on August 2021. So there is another vaccine which is currently in like conducted by China. So I'm hearing some background noise, so if other people will keep on mute, that will be great. Hello. I will appreciate if other people will keep on mute. Thank you, I appreciate it. So the another trial, which is mostly the Chinese companies and the institution is conducting, that is conducted in UAE, Bahrain, and Jordan. So this is also a randomized double-blind placebo study, placebo-controlled, to evaluate the safety and the efficacy. So basically, that vaccine on 14th September, UAE already approved this vaccine for the use of healthcare worker based on the interim analysis, interim result of the phase 3 trial. So as I mentioned earlier, like regulatory agencies are simultaneously reviewing the data, and if they feel like, yeah, this is safe for human, even though the 100% efficacy is not known, but we can at least try for the healthcare worker, so that if it is safe, at least there will not be a side effect, but it may show some kind of effect or some kind of immunity. So that's why like UAE government already approved it for the healthcare workers. And in Abu Dhabi, the target of the completion of this study is July 2021. The another one is again from the Beijing Institute, and this study's sites are in Wuhan and Pakistan. So this is again double blind placebo control to evaluate safety, efficacy, and immunogenicity. And their target date of completion is December 2020 in China. And so that is too early. We are expecting like, hopefully it will be approved early first quarter of the 2021. And in Pakistan, the study might get completed in 2021. So these are the top three which are very promising. And if we see the safety data, most of them have the common side effect, like the injection site pain, headache, fever, chills, and no serious adverse event reported. There are some other vaccines which are already in phase 3. So this one is in Brazil, and again in the collaboration with China and Brazil. So they have the sites in Brazil and Indonesia. And again, this is the double blind randomized placebo control study. The safety data include that most of them have the injection site pain reaction. And again, the target date for the completion is Jan 2021. And in Indonesia and in Brazil, October 2021. Similarly, another study in USA and Germany, which is conducted by Pfizer and some other pharmaceutical companies. The target date is May 20, 2021. And in Moscow, in Russia also, there is one study ongoing. And I think many of you have heard that news or rumor that, especially in the WhatsApp or Facebook, like it's spreading the message that Russia already developed the vaccine and they are already introducing, but that is like a rumor. The study is still ongoing. I believe, I'm not 100% sure, but based on the interim analysis or just on the based on the data of the phase 2 study, they already started introducing to the people. So that is not, I'm 100% sure, but study is still, phase three study is still ongoing. And the completion date of that study is May 2021. So these are the like some of the high level information which are information of the COVID-19 vaccines ongoing which are in the phase three study. So now everyone are very much curious, like if the vaccine get approved, how much it will be effective, how much it will be safe, so and will it be really able to control this pandemic. So there are some facts which we will know when the time will come, but if any of the vaccine have a 70% of efficacy, then it will be like good enough to stop this pandemic, even though not like it is not 100% effective. If it is 70% effective, that will also be helpful for us. But in case if it is less than 60%, the outbreak will still continue. So the efficacy of less than 60% will not provide good enough herd immunity to stop the spread of the virus alone. Like I believe like everyone know what is the herd immunity, but just like this is the high level definition, like it is a indirect protection from the infectious disease by reducing the chances of disease transmission that occur when a sufficient percentage of population has become immune. Basically, it disrupts the chain of infection, which stops or slows the speed of spreading. So, so for a herd immunity, at least in the community, we need at least 70% of the efficacy of that vaccine. So, and what are the other situations where the vaccine will not be effective? Like if the person is immunodeficient, like HIV or some other immunodeficiency syndromes, if he is on the immunosuppression therapy, or if even though after the approval of the vaccines, if there is a huge mutation in the virus, which is like mostly even though there is some small mutation, but still the vaccines are sometimes effective because still they are able to block. Even though mutation is ongoing, and we all know that continuous mutation is ongoing as I mentioned earlier, that most of them are spike protein, and mostly the mutations are occur on the spike protein. So if that happens, there might be the chances of the less efficacy of the vaccine. So but there are I'm sure that at the end also there will be a lot of studies ongoing after the approval, and now like as we are treating the patients, like most of the off-label use, so maybe at that time we need a repetitive booster dose of the vaccines. Even though it is recommended less, but if it is safe, we can increase the dose and having a repetitive booster dose or combinations of the vaccines. But that need again another clinical trial. But that will be the short trial, not like for the development of the vaccine, but for the just the efficacy in the combination of the vaccines. So there are multiple trials again after the approval. Now I will talk about the immunogenicity. Basically, immunogenicity directly talking about the efficacy. If any of the vaccine is able to produce a neutralizing antibodies or binding antibodies against those vaccines, and these are mostly found in the 7 days after the post dose, and actually this data is based on the phase two studies of the most of the studies. This is not the anticipated data, this is already approved data from the phase two studies. So it shows that the vaccine is working, so we are having a very positive hope in the phase three trials. Basically phase two trial have a less amount of patients, so this is the reason like we need to conduct the phase three study as well to determine the correct percentage of efficacy and the safety. And we also found that CD4 and CD8 T cell responses found in the patients who received the vaccines in the phase two studies. So This is about the immunogenicity. So now here comes a very important part, that is a safety. As I mentioned earlier, the studies which are already in the phase three, so and most of them are in phase two phases. So we have the data already received from those clinical trials. So the common adverse events are injection site pain, fever, headache, weakness, fatigue, myalgia. But it varies with different, like these are the most common I'm describing here. Till now, there is no any serious adverse event reported from any of the trial. So it looks pretty safe. However, we are not sure that maybe there might be the hypersensitivity reactions or even anaphylactic reactions. But this is very unlikely to happen because till now we don't see any kind of even serious adverse events. And there is also potential of cytokine storm because of the vaccine. But again, it is very unlikely to happen. But we never know. Maybe in the post-marketing studies or post-marketing data from the spontaneous, when the data will receive from the real-world environment, if we find some events. And I'm sure, like, if any of the vaccine will get these hypersensitivity reactions or cytokine storm kind of reaction, definitely that vaccine will get rejected. But hopefully, we hope for the best. So this is about the safety and the risk of the vaccines. The distribution. So basically, the distribution is obviously when the vaccine is approved, it mostly first allocated to the healthcare professionals because they are the frontline warrior. And again, the high risk patient, which are susceptible for a severe illness or death, like elderly patients or with the comorbidities. So vaccine can be stored in 2 to 8 degrees Celsius for 7 days and 6 hours for the room temperature. So again, this is based on the phase two data. And regarding the distribution, so everyone are like keeping an eye on the Serum Institute of India, as they have, and just in June they have a licensing agreement with AstraZeneca to make 1 billion dose of the vaccines, and which will be very beneficial for India basically. So now another topic is post-marketing surveillance. This is very, very crucial about these vaccines, because even though because as I mentioned earlier, we are rushing the development of vaccine. Otherwise, usually it takes 10 to 15 years. So if we are rushing, definitely most of the data are missing, especially the safety data, because most of the people are already aware that in the clinical trial, we don't include the patient with pregnancy. So the later stages, you know the incidence of phocomelia, right? Which was happened by thalidomide. So it should not happen with these vaccines. So we need to conduct the post-marketing studies. Basically, it will be done for safety of the study. And there is a pharmacovigilance department. They always be involved in the signal detection activity. But yes, definitely it will be conducted after the approval of the vaccine. So I tried to cover like most of the information like in defined timeline. So if anyone have any question on this, please let me know.
Dr. Shukla, can we have any questions if they are there? Dr. Aryan, can you be there with us? Do you have any questions, sir?
I want to know category of vaccine is must be critically most effective in all those categories which you have mentioned. Which particular category of vaccine is theoretically most effective? All those categories you have mentioned.
Sorry, the voice is too much breaking, so I'm not able to hear it. What is the question? Can someone
question is this question? Which particular category therapy of theoretically most effective.
Which type of vaccine you mentioned, four types in fact of vaccines, which of these is likely to be most efficacious? I think that was the question.
So we are having a very promising results from the vaccines which are already in the phase 3 studies, and most of them are protein subunit. These protein subunits are like the spike proteins. But again, even though these are more promising, but again, if there are the lot of mutation in the spike protein, there are the chances that the vaccine will not be effective. So right now, it is just the assumption. We never know. But till now, whatever the data is showing, the efficacy is like the patient are developing the antibodies, the neutralizing antibodies are there, and reacting the T cells. So it shows that yes, definitely it will provide some immunity. So mostly like the, that's why like most of the pharmaceutical companies are involved in this protein subunit vaccine categories.
I would request Dr. Arvind Mann to ask some questions because he's the one who has a lot of experience in this field.
Our concern is about safety, which is also important. And while developing vaccine in a shorter duration, the safety has to be compromised. So that becomes an important issue when we are looking for vaccine over here. Now, distribution of vaccine is also going to be difficult thing to be decided. As you mentioned,
completely agree.
And the at-risk population, but I think there are going to be other issues also involved for that.
Mm-hmm. I agree. Yes, this is the reason I mentioned here that post-marketing surveillance will play a very important role, because we don't want the repeated incidents what happened with the thalidomide in the pregnant ladies, like the babies with the with the abnormalities. So that's why like when it come in the real-time environment, definitely we will also follow up with the patients and the outcome of the pregnancy, especially if the baby have any kind of fetal abnormalities or not. So that cannot be done in the clinical trial, because we never include the pregnant ladies into the trial. Or if someone become pregnant during the trial, after that we definitely follow up with the until the outcome of the pregnancy comes, and definitely that data will come and will be circulated throughout the world, and that will be utilized by other countries as well. So yes, definitely post marketing surveillance will play a very important role, and that include two types of things. One are solicited and one is spontaneous. The spontaneous data is like without doing any studies, we already getting the data from the real-time environment. And the solicited are nothing but the post-marketing studies, which we are conducting some studies to know more about the safety. So these are like past studies, that we call it as the past studies. And we conduct like mostly the pharmaceutical companies are responsible to conduct these studies. And I mentioned, even though the vaccines are approved, but they are always approved with some condition. I have never seen that any product, not even the vaccine, but any product have approved without any commitment. So regulatory agency always give some commitment, approval based on some commitment. So, and mostly are past studies conducted for the safety.
Thank you very much, Dr. A wonderful session, and it was very heartening to hear from a person who's really concerned with the development of the vaccine. Thank you very much, sir, for sharing all your experiences and so nice. Thank you very much, sir.
Thank you.